you there.
He's up late to give you the news you can't get anywhere else early. He fights for truth and justice in the American way. Please welcome our pal from the Paragon Trust Company, the real Tony D, Tony D'Angelo.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, gather around the radio every Tuesday at the same time. We bring on our very good pal, Tony D'Angelo. You can follow him on the X, Tony D'Angelo 7, of course, and YouTube. He has his own channel, which is fabulous. And usually on Thursdays, he unleashes a video for everybody, and we'll look forward to that. Tony, good morning, sir. How are you?
Good morning, Lee Elci. Good morning, everybody. I'm proud to be among you.
So Thursday, you'll have to have a mask on or something like that. Right? What are you going to go as?
I know, and I'll probably start taking bids for somebody wanting to get me to haunt a house.
All right. Let me ask you. Today, we're going to talk about the political industrial complex and lies, right?
Well, yeah, it's... this is interesting. I'm blessed to do these segments every week, and I'm thinking about what I'm going to do maybe Thursday, Friday, and something will come and just knock my rear off my chair. And yesterday, didn't have a lot of time to get on X Twitter, but a very nice person in one of my groups had posted a selfie picture of our Lieutenant Governor Susan Bisewitz and Susan Raff of Channel 3 News, and they were posing for a selfie, and it's like, well, here's the two Susans, and here we are early voting. And I, Lee Elci, I just saw red, and it's this whole thing of this incestuous relationship, pardon the term, between the Connecticut politicians and the media partners. And that's actually a term that Susie B. uses. But here they are, and they're like, hey, this is great. You know, maybe we'll go out for coffee and all kinds of stuff like that. And all I did is I just took this picture, and I said, okay, here's the lieutenant governor. Here is a prominent news journalist from a network affiliate, and this is it. You know, do you get it? And I mean, this thing rocked around, you know, because I wanted to show this to people, you know, the people that will follow us from out of state. And it's like, or the people that follow me on Twitter, it caused a riot. And as well, it should, because it's this whole thing of, hey, you know, this is the how we do things. We're collegial. We're this, we're that. And I mean, think of it this way. Okay, got the World Series, right? And I can go into my whole I hate baseball these days tirade. But what if Shohei Ohtani and the home plate umpire from the game of the previous night, where you know the ump didn't call a corner on Ohtani, and they were out seeing early voting, there would be a riot.
Right.
What if Lee Elci were the governor and Tony D'Angelo were a radio show host, and we were seeing early voting together and taking a selfie? There would be a riot. But for some reason, when they all do it, it's okay. When anybody else does it, it's this horrible sin. And this is where, and then you talk about seeing red. I thought about this. A moment that was a perfect visionary, and I yell and I scream at Republicans because I say, you guys play into this mess. You play into this media political complex as if it is, quote unquote, you know, you are an equal player. You are not. You are not. They are using you as a foil, or perhaps that is the intention. I don't know. But like another thing that dawned on me, many things are hitting me in the head these days. Maybe it's just the time and the season. Was blessed to be out with Marty Olson on Wednesday, you know, doing Marty's show. And that's always a treat. I wish I could do it every week. I wish I could get down there. But now here's Marty, right? And Marty is the former mayor of New London. Okay, Marty is a formidable force, and we're talking about, you know, we're just a couple of guys, you know, yakking at the table, and he said, now, and he looked at me, if I've got this wrong, Marty, word for word, I wholeheartedly apologize, but he said, Chris Murphy's running, now, who's the guy he's running against? So what's his name, Casey or something? I'm driving home that night, and I'm saying, this man was the mayor, he's a Republican mayor, doesn't even know who Matt Corey is, and you know something? And this is the whole thing. And I say this to Matt Corey. It's like, who advises you, Matt? Who advises you? You play to these people, and it's like, can't do you any favors. And it's like, then you see the picture of Raff and Bisewitz. And finally, you know, I'm just a stupid rockhead from Stanford. It dawns on me. The only thing politicians have is managed information. That is their stock and trade. So many of them, not all of them. They have no policies. They have no substance. But their value is getting you to think what they want you to think. And whenever something comes out, or whenever, like, I might do something, or Collie might do something, or you might do something, you know, that's factual, that's documented. Oh, conspiracy. Oh, this, oh, that. You know why? Because it cuts against the narrative. And like, the Trump rally. And it brought me down to the Trump rally. We were all kind of going around on Twitter on Sunday. It's like, where are you watching this? Where are you seeing it? And so many of these little independent, whatever you want to call it, media outlets, you know, they have these kind of herky-jerky reporters that, if you could even call them that, that, like, talk over everything, and they think they're Edward R. Murrow, and they're insulting, and they're aggravating. I went, and believe me, I didn't find this on my own. I went to the Sky News feed out of Britain, and what it was brilliant. It was just a camera. And the camera was just running. No commentary, no talkovers, you know, no irritating Shannon Bream in your ear. And they were focusing on the crowd and the people waiting to get in. And there was finally, I guess, whatever time it was, about 3:30, the police said, okay, folks, you can move on. And this violent mob of insurrectionists, this violent mob of Adolf Hitler devotees in the redo of the 1939 Madison Square Garden. Lee Elci, I've seen more violent crowds go to religious services. These people were so polite. They were respectful. They were thanking the police. The police were thanking them back, telling them to go in and have a nice rally. But two things got me in this crowd that I was observing. And this had me to tears. There was a dad, maybe a dad about my age, and he had an adult blind son. And the adult blind son, you know, if ever you've been, you know, in public with a blind person, I have a very dear blind friend. I've been with them a lot. You walk with them. They either put their arms around you or, you know, however they like to hold you. And this son had his arms around his dad's neck. His dad is walking into the garden. The dad's got tears in his eyes. And then there's another Jewish father, and the Jewish father, I don't know, maybe he's like in his 40s, with a young, you know, son, presumably a Jewish son, and they're wrapped in the flag of Israel, politely going into the garden. And I'm saying to myself, you know, these arrogant SOBs pretty much tell you what they want to do. They free you from your feelings. And, I mean, I think of this guy. I think of this guy with the adult blind son. He didn't abort him. You know, he didn't kill him. He didn't treat his wife as, you know, he raised him to an adult, and he's still believing, you know, for America. So it's like I'm thinking these people just want to separate you from your beliefs and your feelings. And when you want to say, no, that's not correct, no, prove the stupid accusation that you're making, you're derided, you're called terrible names. And then you look to, quote unquote, elected officials to say, well, will you push back a bit? No, they're playing into the same mess. And it's just and I should mention this, because I am old enough to have worked under and had friends, fathers and mothers, and new people who were in concentration camps, who had the markings on their arms, were oppressed by Nazis, who were driven from their homeland. Bob Duff, the great Senate Majority Leader of Connecticut, the champion of Savior of us all, he's got videos right now. I checked them out before I came out here, you know, to talk on the phone. He is accusing Trump of this horrible Nazism, and this is 1939, and it's like, you know, okay, Bob, you got a First Amendment right to say whatever you want. Yeah, you're an elected official, and you shouldn't be reckless and that sort of thing. But where's the Republican pushback? One senator, Rob Sampson, makes a very polite, congenial statement, but it's not nearly enough. Every single freaking Republican right now should be calling for Bob Duff's removal or to step down, however that plays in the Constitution of the state. You know, when you're talking Nazism, when you're talking the murder of Jewish people, not only that, the Jewish people are going into the rally. They're dancing the Habanagila outside of Madison Square Garden. It's like, and I go back to the picture of the two Susans voting. They tell you what they want to believe, what they want for you to believe. And the thing is, how many things, Lee Elci, over the past 5 years, how many ways have they lied to us? You know, I listed out some lies. These are actually kind of hysterical, if you look at it. And it's, okay, here's just some of the things they told us that weren't true. New York hates Trump. They can't stand him, right? He's this terrible guy. You know, they got to take his buildings. They got to demean him. Then the political people, right? Republicans said it's a waste campaigning for Trump in the Northeast because he has no following. Draw your own conclusions. How about Ned Lamont did a great job during COVID? Connecticut's coming back. Crime is down. The COVID vaccine was safe and effective. We need housing because the state is booming and our elections are safe and under control. There's no fraud. And, you know, we must avoid Donald Trump at all costs. It's like this all hit me like a ton of bricks. It's like these people serially lie to us. They serially tell us what they want us to believe. They want to separate us from our feelings. They want to make us ashamed of who we are and what we're doing. Guess what? Not this kid anymore, folks. You think you've had it hard now? Just wait. Your ball.
So I got a message from one of our great state representatives. He says the House Republican press office reached out to Susan Raff on her as far as the Stonington early voting ballot issue, and she didn't want to run the story because she didn't want people to know that there was a problem with early voting. So that right there, that says enough as far as the credibility of those folks. As far as the Hitler thing, I mean, there is nothing more
despicable.
Diabolical, despicable. I mean, and here's the problem. The media is picking this thing up, and they are running towards the goal line because this is all they have left, Tony. They got nothing else. Kamala's an empty suit. She brings nothing to the table. There's no substance. There's nothing there. So all that they can do is throw as much negative energy at Trump as they possibly can. Look at this whole fiasco with the Puerto Rican joke that was told. Trump didn't tell the joke. I mean, and they make it sound like he sort of gave his seal of approval.
And he hates Puerto Rican people, yeah,
of course.
Which is like... It's so far from the truth.
Exactly. So, you know, and on all levels, this thing is they're trying their best to orchestrate some massive push against Donald Trump here in the last 7 days to see if they can affect the election. And you know what? They probably will to a certain extent, Tony, with this kind of rhetoric. You know, everywhere I go, I hear the same thing. Oh, he's Hitler. He's Hitler. He's Hitler. It's a horrible thing to say about anybody. Obviously.
Well, I mean, you go back to the Nazi rally in 1939. I don't think there were Jewish people outside of the old 8th Avenue Garden dancing, doing the Jewish celebratory dance. I mean, it's like it is so... I don't know. I mean, whatever that movie was that completely escapes me at this point, where they are telling you their narrative, and believe me, it's like, you know, people want it like another thing. Hey, we have a racial problem in this country. Let me tell you the racial problem in Connecticut. There's them and there's us.
Yeah.
That's the racial problem.
Yeah.
Okay. When they tell you what they want for you to know, and you're not supposed to look anywhere else. You're not supposed to get anywhere else. I mean, it's like, okay, you know, believe what you want to believe. We're free moral agents. We can believe whatever it is. But when you're getting what really is sourced misinformation cloaked in some sort of whatever you want to call it, Lee Elci, a cloud of plausible believability, what you're really getting is an infomercial. What you're really getting is a sight gag.
Right.
And which is, hey, fine, if that's what you want to do, but businesses are lost, lives are wrecked, marriages are wrecked, you know, and it's how much of what they've told us is true? When we look back over 5 years and a lot, you know, just about was any of it true? Yeah, there were smatterings of it, but, you know, and all we really need is information. You know, and I get this all the time, you know, like I'm doing work, and people ask me, you know, what makes a good tax policy? It's simple. Flat, fair, easy, conceptual. You know, it should not, taxation should not be a war against the people. And there should be, you know, it would be a whole lot easier on politicians who know as much about, you know, tax and fiscal policy as I might about building the neutron bomb. But basically, it's like, well, you know, our tax is 3.5%. I want to get that down to 2.5%. Concentrate on other more productive business. But they don't. They use it as a cloak. Harris comes out and talks about the opportunity economy. He's talking about that with Marty. Where's the opportunity? Tell me about what the opportunity is. I mean, opportunity to me is a low tax rate, a lesser bureaucracy, kind of a, you know, reworking, or if not a torching, of the administrative state, and just making things easy and workable so people understand them, so the country could grow, so the state can grow. But the problem is, if the state grows, people develop their own independence. They develop their own independence and mindset. They look at the politicians and say, you know, you're a freaking idiot. All you've told me for years after taking my money is a bunch of lies. And that's what they don't want to happen.
Tony D'Angelo, follow him on the X, Tony D'Angelo 7. Of course, the YouTube. We'll get to that before we run out of time. But did you want to get to part two of this?
Yeah, we'll go quick on this. This article played around. It was actually, I think, I don't get the Norwich Bulletin, but I think I saw it coming out of the store on Sunday. There is something, and I believe it was, as the Colonel says, above the fold on the Sunday paper. There is a program in Connecticut called Time to Own, and it is a the State Bond Commission has allocated an amount of money for first-time home buyers. You know, typical thing that goes on, press release goes out, the newspapers just publish it without any sort of credibility or verification. And it's this thing of you get an average of a $30,000 down payment, forgivable loan if you do certain things, and. And the governor and the housing commissioner, I believe her name is Celia Mascaro Bruno, were out saying about how wonderful it is so people could own their homes. And I'm thinking, gee, didn't they tell us that single-family homes were racist and the people that lived in them were KKK members? But hey, what do I know, right? So it's like, and started to read this and started to look at it. And one of my very, and this thing, if we have this housing shortage, and one of my very astute group members said to me, you know, hey, Tony, you realize something. You don't have to be a citizen at all to be a part of this. You just need to be a resident. And one of the things that really got me, and this is the thing, we're now taking these media abuses without questioning them. And I'm reading right from the article. The program has had a particular focus on helping people of color who were historically and systematically shut out of the home buying market for decades to purchase houses. More than half the people who participated in the program so far are people of color, according to a press release from Governor Ned Lamont's office. So in other words, reverse racism is just fine. That's absolutely okay. The Fair Housing Act in 1968, everybody's got an equal shot. You know, we're not going to bother to look at it. So it's basically, you know, it's this whole thing of here they are. This is wonderful. Well, are they stuffing their loyalists in these houses? Are they stuffing illegals? I mean, you need not be a citizen to participate in this. And the State Bond Commission pretty much said, hey, this is great. You know, let's go ahead and do it. One legislator, apparently, Henry Martin of Bristol, said he was kind of right for the wrong reasons. He says, I'm not a big advocate of giving people into this type of funding to buy a home. I'd rather, I'd rather there be a bigger litmus test. But basically, you know, what it comes down to is the state, you and I, are the financiers for whatever in the heck they want to do. And, you know, what I'd like to see a Senator Martin do, what I'd like to see other people, hey, this is wrong. What are we doing as far as, are these people, you know, look, I mean, you're giving preference to one particular race. There's something, and you can argue all the equity stuff all you want. It's still not right. It's still not right. And I mean, it is the kind of thing, and I guess it takes us back to the beginning of the discussion. They tell you what they want for you to believe, and you're supposed to believe it. And it's like, if you are this person who says, no, what you're telling me is incorrect, you're derided and all kinds of stuff like that. I mean, man, oh man, if Republicans take control of this, great, fantastic, but man, oh man, they got to do a whole lot better than what they've been doing, let me tell you.
Tony D'Angelo, Tony D'Angelo 7. Look for him on Halloween, releasing another video up on his YouTube page. Tony, as always, thank you, my friend.
Thanks, pal.
All right, you have
Thanks,
a good
everybody.
One. We'll come right back in just a couple seconds. I think we got a rip and read coming your way. No Bruce Flax today. Stick around. A lot going on. Chip Beckett at the top of the hour. Independent Party. Brian Johnson and Amanda Werkel.